Well, in 1864, three civil rights workers that did travel over into Philadelphia to investigate a church burning that the Klan had burned a few nights before. And while there, they were viciously murdered by members of the Ku Klux Klan. Well, for 40 years, no one talked about those murders in Philadelphia. It was as if they never occurred. I mean, well, 40 years later, a friend of mine who was a high school classmate and someone who I worked with and had developed a great relationship with, and he had just bought the local newspaper. He was a white newspaper editor. And he and I decided, you know, let's do something for the 40th anniversary to commemorate the murders that occurred here. And when we convened a group of people together, it became apparent that when we got to talking about what we wanted to do, everyone kept saying we need to ask for justice. But we noticed that how could we truly say seek justice when we never dealt with our past? No one had ever asked for the state of Mississippi to prosecute anyone for those murders. And one of the things we decided to do, it's time for this community to stand together and do the right thing. It was always about this community coming together as one unit and speaking with one voice to do the right thing. So that's what we did. We convened a group of people together with like minds, because many of the people there were from all different walks of life. I mean, we had people from preachers to politicians to just everyday laymen, bankers, merchants. So it was pretty much a cross section of the population in Philadelphia that came together. We just spent time getting to know each other, introducing ourselves, talking about where we wanted to see our city, what were some of the things in our city that we loved about our city. And during the course of those conversations, people started to open up and tell their stories. And you could see a change starting to occur in the room, because those stories, people started to understand the hurt and pain that their neighbors felt. And it was some of these stories was the first time they'd ever been shared with anybody from the opposite race. We asked the families for their forgiveness for what happened, for the murders that occurred there to their loved ones, also to forgive us for not doing anything for 40 years. And then from our next step, we moved on to the process of asking the state attorney general if he would reopen the case. 41 years to the date of the murders, we had a conviction.
I contacted Betty Kilby Baldwin and her brother James Kilby, and found out that he had been working very hard to get the school that he and Betty had worked so hard to integrate named after their father. And I decided what I could do was join his organization to help him in that cause. But I felt that the best way I could do that was to stand beside them and take action together, that's the way that would be deepened, the healing and the connection.
My father had been working on the renaming of the school for a few years before before Phoebe joined the committee. And once she joined, I think he was re-energized through her compassion and empathy. He just seemed to feel like there was someone there that understood his struggle. During the final hearing, Phoebe stood up and testified in front of the school board, and she stood there and introduced herself as a descendant of the Kilby slaveholders. And it was amazing for me, not only for me, but my 90-year-old grandmother witnessed it, my 12-year-old son witnessed it, and the people of Front Royal also witnessed her supporting the family. What it really felt and meant to us was that as a family, we could come together and work together and make things happen.